I'm going to be presenting in English because it's recorded on YouTube so that it can have a wider audience. So my name is Vojta Kral and I came here today to tell you something more about the recommender systems. So if you are wondering, or if you have been wondering, for example, how Netflix does it to recommend you movies to watch, or how Amazon recommends you stuff to buy, the same for YouTube, how they do it to recommend you videos, or for example, how Facebook suggests you friends or posts to read. You are in the right place, and I'm gonna give you an overview covering pretty much everything. So I'm gonna start with the introduction of myself and the domain. Then I'm gonna look at the first section would be non-personalized recommendations. It will be a much shorter section, and then we're gonna dig deeper into the much interesting stuff, which would be the personalized one. And then some 10 last slides, I'm gonna be talking about what's there beyond the algorithms, because algorithms is just one part to have a good recommender system, but there are much more. So introduction of myself. So actually about 3 years ago and more, I have been sitting in the same spot that you are today. So I was studying FIT. I graduated in 2013 from my master's in software engineering. That was my major. Then I joined, right after my graduation, I joined the graduate program at Barclays. I don't know if many of you heard, Barclays is a British investment bank and they actually have a technological IT center, about 400 people here in Prague. So I joined that office as a programmer. And currently, I am a leading developer of a RS, stands for Recommender System, in Prague office in a department at Barclays. And the introduction of the domain. So why am I talking about recommender systems, or why is it so important today? And I'm gonna use example of a bookstore. So let's say you own a bookstore, and which books are you going to stuff in your shelves? One point is you have a limited shelf space, so you can afford to stuff everything and sell everything. So what you're gonna do, you're probably gonna buy or stock most popular books, because with most popular books you have a decent chance to sell them comparing to least popular books. So you're gonna get most popular books, you're gonna stuff them, and you're gonna start selling them. Then if you look at it from the customer point of view, if I walk into the bookstore, most likely the bookstore will not be super huge, so I will be able to get oriented myself, find what I'm looking for, get a book, etc. In comparison, if you own an online bookstore, and an example of that would be Amazon, there are many more, but if you, I just picked it as an example. So if you own an online bookstore, what's your shelf space? Pretty much unlimited, right? So you can afford to sell pretty much any book in the world. In these terms, you can, you're gonna stock it from the most popular to the not as much popular, to the more niche products. And then if me as a customer, if I walk into your page, and there will be much bigger selection for me to choose from. And let's say we don't have a recommender system, and I might, you know, the situation might turn out that I might actually not find what I'm looking for because of the number of choices I have. I might suffer what's called an information overload. So I have too many choices to choose from that I'm overwhelmed and I just not gonna buy anything and I'm gonna leave. Then similar example is if you are a customer who is interested in niche products. So if you are interested in some particular books that are not, you know, super famous, super popular, but you just like reading those part of those books, then in the real store, bookstore, you're probably not gonna find them because they are not as popular, so why the owner should have them on the store, because they're gonna just sell one in half a year, for example. If you're gonna go to the online bookstore, those books, if you don't have a recommender system, those books will not probably be exposed on the front page. So you will have to do some clicking around, you know, some drilling, searching into categories to be able to find your niche books that you are looking for. And that's why we have, you know, the domain of recommender systems came to be more and more popular as users and people basically were consuming content on the internet more and more. So consuming can be buying books, can be watching movies, can be, you know, reading articles, etc. Because the online version of the stores, they don't have that restriction on the space, so they can afford to sell much broader variety of stuff. And that's where it's very useful to have a recommender system, because you can mitigate that information overload. So if the customer comes in and you know that customer from the previous interaction, you can surface it, the relevant products to them much sooner. So they will not be overwhelmed and they can end up picking and consuming an item. And that's pretty much a win-win situation, because the customer will be satisfied, they're gonna consume, watch, buy whatever your system is selling or offering. And then the same, on the other hand, the system owner, the one who runs the site, they are gonna have happy customer, they're, for example, sell stuff, etc. So they can, for example, have a big revenue. So it's a win-win situation. And then the term long tail, that's connected to the niche product that I was saying. So the stuff that are less popular, the niche stuff, they would be at the kind of a longer tail. And if you surface them to the customer, they will find it much sooner. They will not have to do much drilling in your website. So this is just an intro to why it's important nowadays. And now let's look at the personalized, because you have like two families in a rough split. You can have personalized recommendations and non-personalized recommendations. So we're gonna first start with the non-personalized recommendations. And question, what can be a non-personalized recommendation? Does anybody have an idea? Okay, so I picked one, I did a screenshot. So this is a screenshot of hotels.com, and I just happened, you know, for the purpose of this example, I was searching hotels in Prague. And you can, no, I don't know if you can see it much, up there, it's sorted by what they call our favorite. So obviously, I don't know how hotels.com recommendation work, but very likely our favorite will be something that would be shown to all the customers. So no matter if you are your person A, person B, person C, you will gonna see the same, because that category might be some aggregated results of, you know, what we think is best, what the customers rated the best, etc. You can also have, you might see the fourth one is guest rating. So again, that kind of like presentation will be shown according to what people thought were the best. So everybody who goes to that page will see it exactly the same, because that will be produced by aggregated statistics. So the characteristic of non-personalized recommendations is everybody sees the same, that's why it's called non-personalized. Then it's usually produced via aggregating some results. So it will be most bought, most watched, highest rated, etc. And these recommenders, or this style of recommending, you can see, for example, in the terms of hotels, restaurants, vacation spots, in the cases where you, for example, your search location and it's gonna pop up best hotel in this area. So this best hotel would most likely be produced, or this rating would be most likely produced by aggregating, you know, previous customer rating. Then another part that also falls into non-personalized recommendations is called product association. I believe many of you have seen, if you are buying stuff, then at some point you're gonna see, you know, other customers who bought this also bought the other thing. And you can, you know, add it into your basket. And this is not personalized, because to this outcome you can arrive by analyzing purchase logs. So you're just gonna look at which products were bought together, and if you're gonna see that I have the product A is already in my basket, and this product is often bought with some other product, you're gonna tell me other users also bought the product B. I think you should, you know, add it in your basket and buy as well. So that's also non-personalized, because anybody who has that product A will be shown the same results. And then there's another thing that The term is ephemeral recommendations. The ephemeral means short history. So it sits somewhere on the edge between like personalized and non-personalized, because short history means, for example, just your session. So I'm gonna go to page, and it just will consider the last 2 minutes of my clicking on that page. So the path through which I went before I got to the final stage. And then if you're gonna close the browser, obviously we'll restart. So everybody who has the same path will see the same results. So that would be non-personalized. Now let's look at the personalized one, because those are the, I think, more interesting ones. So it has, there are two families under personalized. One is a content-based. I'm gonna be talking about it, I'm gonna give you an example as well. Another one is collaborative filtering. Again, I'm gonna be talking about it. But what's similar to those two methods, so these two, content-based and collaborative filtering, they use users' history, users' feedback, and users' action throughout the history with interaction with the system to do the prediction, to give you recommendations. And there's also one assumption for these two methods is that your past has to be able to predict your future, meaning that if I like a movie today, it's very, very likely that I'm gonna like it tomorrow, and I'm gonna like it in half a year, etc. So it cannot be the case that today I like something, tomorrow I dislike it, then a week down the road I'm gonna like it again. So it cannot be flipping back and forth, it has to be somewhat consistent. And I was talking about the feedback, so the history feedback and user interactions. So how can users give feedback to the system, or how is it usually given to the system? One is called the explicit feedback, which means you're gonna give some number on a scale, or you're gonna give it stars. So it would be the case, I'm gonna give it 4 stars out of 5, and it means I like, for example, that movie. So that's explicit rating. The other category would be the implicit rating, and that would be interpreting user actions throughout the interaction in your system. Typical user actions would be, if you take 3, you can have viewed the item, put the item in the basket, and bought the item. So if I bought the item, you can be pretty sure that I like the item, or it's much more meaning, it means much more that I liked it. If I put the item in the basket, that somewhat means I probably like that item, but it's gonna have less weight or strength than if I bought it. If I just viewed the item, that's the similar case. It's maybe I liked it, I definitely the strength or the certainty is less than if I put it into the basket. So that would be the implicit feedback, observing user action. And then also another difference between implicit and explicit is explicit puts more cognitive load on the user, because I know you think it's just click a 4-star, but you have to first decide how many stars I want to give it to it. So you have to think, is it 3, is it 4, you are comparing to, for example, previous movies. So you have to put some energy into basically give that feedback. So obviously you have much less explicit feedback than implicit feedback, because interpreting just user actions, you don't need any extra work from the user. But another point with implicit feedback that you have to be mindful of is with implicit feedback, you don't have negative actions, or it's much harder to get negative feedback. Because if you observe that I bought an item, good. It's like, one, I probably like it. But if you don't see that I bought an item, what does it mean? It can mean either I decided not to buy it, or I just did not see it. So you have the probability that it's either a negative feedback, the user did not want to buy it, or the user didn't see it, and you have no idea which one of these it would be. But in terms of explicit, if I'm going to give you 1 star, the user didn't like it. That's obvious negative feedback. And now let's look at some first method, content-based. So what I said is it works with the art. I didn't say it. Say it. So it works with the content, and the content can have multiple approaches to the content. So you may think about content of an article, and you automatically can start thinking about natural language processing, phrases, etc. That can be one thing. The other thing that also falls into this category is, if you're going to work with movies, content would be any metadata that's assigned to it. So it's going to be director, main actor, genre, etc. And I'm going to describe it on an example. So we're going to take an example of movies. And let's say we're going to have 5 movies. For the purpose of presentation, I picked Rocky, Rocky 2, Rambo, Titanic, and Holiday. And the thing we're going to track in this example, recommended approach, is going to be main actors. Main actors slash main actors. The reason why I picked main actor is, if we track genre, which might be, you know, more obvious for you, we would have to somehow define how much this movie is, for example, romance, how much it is action, etc. So you have to do some pre-processing before we can work with it. But if you're gonna work, if you're gonna show it on an example of main actors, that basically shows you how you can work with when you have a metadata that are either there or not. So it would be either 1 and 0, and you don't have to do pre-processing. Depends on your case. So we're gonna have movies. We have main actors. And you know, for first three movies, I really think that the main actor was Sylvester Stallone, Rocky, Rocky 2, Rambo. And then Titanic, I think we agree that there are two main actors, Leonardo DiCaprio and Kate Winslet. And the Holiday, I picked for the purpose of example, two main actors, Kate Winslet and Cameron Diaz. So we have movies. And one thing is, let's say this is the only movies we have in our system. There are no more movies we can offer, we have just this one, these ones. And we're gonna have a user, let's call him Bob, and we know that he saw Rocky 1. We don't have any record if he's, that he saw Rocky 2, Rambo, and Titanic. And he saw also the Holiday. And so what are we going to do first in this method is, we can, or we're going to put the movies and the users into the vector space. So let's say, just an example, we're gonna put a movie here, it would be Rocky. So we're gonna put it as a vector. Then we have another movie, again, as a vector. And here we have Bob, the user, again, as a vector. And this vector would represent his taste. And then how you can do recommendations, how you're gonna go about it is, you're gonna look at the cost, for example, cosine similarity, so the cosine of this angle, and the more similar it is, so the lower angle it has, the more likely Bob will like that movie. And so how are we going to do it? So for the purpose of making vectors out of items, we're going to do, let's say we have 4 dimensions. Each dimension is an actor. And we're gonna put ones where the actor start in the movie. And zeros where the actor didn't start in the movie. So the vector for Rocky would be 10000, as you can see. Then how are we gonna go about the user vector, finding their taste? So we know that Bob saw Rocky and he saw Holiday. And just very simplified approach could be, we can just simply add that up, meaning we're gonna just count, we're gonna sum up every movie with Sylvester Stallone that Bob saw. Since Bob saw only Rocky, that's 1. If Bob's seen Rocky and Rocky 2, we would put here 2, because 1 plus 1. He didn't see any movie with Leonardo DiCaprio, so it's gonna be 0. And because of the Holiday, we're gonna put Kate Winslet 1 and then Cameron Diaz 1. And what you may notice here is, one thing that you might wanna do is, you may want to normalize these vectors. Normalization means that you're gonna put them at the length of 1. What is it going to result in? You're gonna kind of like scale down these values, and the interpretation of that would be, because if you're going to look at this like that, and you have 1 and 1, that is saying that if a movie has 10 actors and all of them have ones, then if all of them have ones, it means they are equally contributed to your experience or to your liking, disliking, as if there was just one actor, because all of them have ones. But probably, if there are, you know, 10 actors or 100 actors comparing to one, each of the 100 actors should have lower weight on your user taste. So if you're going to normalize it, the vectors with, or in our case, the movies with more actors would score each of them lower number, which is kind of like follows the reality. But let's keep it this way. It works as well for us, for this case, and we have the user taste here. We have movies, and so the next step is obviously, let's say we're going to compute cosine similarity. Cosine similarity ranges from minus 1 to 1. 1 means the same or the similar, minus 1 means the opposite. And I computed it for you. So we know that Bob saw Rocky, that's out of the picture, we know he saw it. And here we are computing the similarity for the three movies he did not see. And if we should say now, what are we going to present to Bob as a topmost recommendation? We would present him these two, because they have the highest similarity to his vector, which represents his taste in the history. But that's interesting, but there's another tweak or another glitch. Usually what you do in content-based recommendations, you count for the importance. What I mean by the importance, in our case with movies, you would count, I'm going to give you an example. So let's say if Sylvester Stallone is in every movie we have, then if I watched, or if in my user vector Sylvester Stallone appears, that's kind of like probability of one, because he's in every movie that we have, so there's, you know, one probability that I've seen a movie with him. Which means the decision factor, or the weight on making a decision if Sylvester Stallone should play a big part in deciding should we recommend this one or not, this should not have such a big role, because he appears in any movie, so it shouldn't be a decision factor on shall we recommend it or not. On the other hand, if we have an actor that appears in three movies out of 1,000, and I've seen one of those three movies, then probably I'm gonna like the other two as well, because this actor played starred in just few movies, and I just watched that other one, that one of the three. And that, or this approach, can be, or is named, or how you calculate it, would be TF-IDF, that's coming from the search area. The TF stands for term frequency, so this means that's a part that says how often or how much is a term, in our case, a metadata tag, so an actor in a movie. For us, it's just one or zero. The actor is there or is not there. Other way how you can interpret the TF would be how many minutes he appeared in the movie, and you can just count it up. But for us, it's just one or zero. The IDF says inverse document frequency, so that's that importance. So what you're gonna do, how you can count it, you can, for example, take all the movies that we have, it's gonna be 5, divide by the movies where the actor appears, and take logarithms out of that. And that will, let's look at numbers. So what I did, the same table as you saw before, and here we have the IDF, the inverse document frequency, which drives the importance of each kind of like tag or metadata. And you can see that Sylvester Stallone has a pretty low weight, because he appears in more than half of the movies. So he shouldn't be a decision factor on, you know, should I recommend it to Bob or shouldn't I? Because he appears in more than half. On the other hand, Kate Winslet, she appeared only in two movies out of our test set.
So she has higher weight, and the same for Leonardo DiCaprio. He just won, so it's going to be 5 divided by 1, and logarithms out of that.
And how can we factor in those importances in making prediction? So what you can do, you can take these numbers and just multiply the previous table by the appropriate number. So it's going to turn into this one. So what I did, I just took the appropriate idea number value and multiply the extra column by that. Then this is our old user vector, and we're not going to change it. Let's say the way how we gathered it, how we counted it up, that's good for our case. So that's here, and now we're going to do the same as before. We're going to run cosine similarity to find out which of these three, because they were not seen by Bob, are the closest to the Bob's vector. We're going to find out. Surprise, surprise. You can see here that Rambo and Rocky actually scored under Titanic. They are less important now to be recommended, or they have a lower score to be recommended than Titanic. So if we count in the importance, if you remember before, they scored above, slightly above Titanic, but after we factor in the IDF, the inverse document frequency, suddenly we would recommend that the topmost recommendation for Bob would be Titanic. And that's content based. So just to wrap it up, so what I'm going to do, you're going to put items in a vector space, put them as vectors, then you're going to learn the user profile. We did it very simple way, you know, you can do other more sophisticated ways how to learn user profile, and it's good to count for importance. That was the idea of what we did. Oh, one thing, if you have any questions, feel free to ask anytime. Interrupt me. Any questions? Okay. Now, there was one family, and if you remember, I said that the collaborative filtering is the other family. And it has two approaches. One would be called the neighborhood model, and the other one would be called matrix factorization. So let's look at the neighborhood model first. So let's say we have two, I'm going to use the audience. Let's say we have two people, and it's going to be me and I think a gentleman in stripes. And let's say, you know, we are friends and we know about each other that we have a similar taste in movies. We know that we agreed on movies. And suddenly you come to me and you say, Avoita, I've seen a super awesome movie this weekend. I absolutely loved it. And what's going on in my head? So I know that you have similar tastes as I do. We like and dislike the same movies. So I should probably go and watch that movie just based on the fact that I know we agree. And that's basically what this method is about. So it's gonna count with how much similar history with ratings, with likes and dislikes we have in the past. And it's gonna do prediction based out of that. So the only input in all collaborative filtering methods is the past behavior. So viewer, viewing, reading, buying history. Just the information about the behavior. And of course, in the reality, it gets more complex because we're not going to just base my recommendations out of one person, but we're going to, for example, pick 5. And what we would do, if I'm going to say, I'm going to look for 5 people most similar to you out of the population over here. First, what I'm going to do, I'm going to count the similarities, each of you, to my ratings, my rating history. And then when I'm doing recommendations, I'm going to look at the movies that you saw, the 5, I'm going to call them neighbors, the 5 people most similar to me, I'm going to look at the movies they saw and I did not see. And the rating prediction is going to be put together from how much similar each of you to me is. That's going to be the weight
on the ratings that I'm going to be shown. So, you know, if somebody is 0.9, similar to myself, and they rated the movie 5 stars, it's going to have much bigger weight on the 5 stars, it's going to be much closer to 5 star. If the other person, for example, has similarity just 0.2 and they rated it 3 stars. And that's what this method is about. So if you have two movie sets, Bob and John, and if we know that they have 95% of overlap, what can we tell about this snippet, red snippet? We can say that John will most likely like it. And that's it. So it works with similarity of users, and as I said, it's based on the consume or rated item. And the one thing you have to kind of like set would be the neighborhood size. So this has to be determined by trial and error, by your domain, by the audience you have. You have to find out what's the good number of neighborhoods. Because if you're gonna pick too little, too low, then, you know, if I'm gonna pick one, then for example, the one neighbor did not see any movies or doesn't have any additional movies that I haven't seen, or we're gonna get too much noise, or too bad data. If you're gonna pick too big of a neighborhood, we're gonna get too much noise. And one thing to mention here is, once you calculate the neighborhood size or the neighbors, you cannot just let it be and just good, work done, because people tastes are changing. So, you know, we may be, or the gentleman in stripes, we may have similar tastes today, maybe tomorrow, in a week, but not in a half a year. We're gonna diverge. So you have to be recalculating the neighbors. So that's another method. So what they thought is, let's take similar or quite similar approach and let's just turn it 90 degrees to the side. And instead of finding similar users, let's say that, you know, user tastes are not as stable, they can diverge, but items are pretty much stable. Once they are well established in the system, then that's not very likely that, you know, if I have two similar items today, that they're, in the terms of rating, that they're gonna be, you know, super dissimilar in a year. So it's less likely. So what they did is just looking at the item similarities, so how similar their ratings are, and they use it to do recommendations for users as well. Because they're gonna look at what are the most similar items that once I've rated, and weight it by the similarity, and then give me the ratings. Cool. Now the most interesting one. Matrix factorization, or I found several terms: latent factors, feature modeling, dimensionality reductions, SVD-like approach. Pretty much all point to the same approach. And this approach is as well collaborative filtering, so it uses behavior. So only pass data. And this one works with the fact that there are latent features hidden, or drivers, you can call it, in the behavior itself. And it tries to discover those drivers in basically the group behavior. And then, you know, come to a prediction, but it's gonna be more clear after the example. And it came, I don't know if all of you know Netflix, probably yes. So this approach came to be used in recommender system area as a result of the Netflix prize. And just give you a little bit words about the Netflix prize competition. So that happened between 2006 and 2009, and the prize money was $1 million. The main goal was to reduce Netflix recommender error by 10%. And it took the team 3 years to win it, actually. And one fun fact is that the first and the second place, they scored the same error reduction, so, but after the 3 years, they were only 24 minutes apart in the submission. It's pretty interesting. Another fun fact from the Netflix competition. So the
matrix factorization method came or was published or popularized after the first year, because at the end of each year they were giving progress prizes. And after the first year, the winning team, they got something like 8.3, 8.4 reduction out of the 10 that was target. And as a result, you know, matrix factorization method was popularized, was published, etc. And this was actually looked at by Netflix, and it was, you know, used, it was put into production. Comparing to the final solution after a few years, the final solution was combining somewhere around 500 models, and it was actually Netflix people look at it, and that's from the use case study from a book I'm going to tell you about at the end, have it in the resources. And they look at it, and just the cost of achieving additional, you know, 1.5-1.6% comparing to how much they would have to invest, how much effort they would have to invest to put that whole model into the production, the winning model, they just thought that's doesn't, you know, the trade-off, it wasn't as good, so they did not put the whole solution into production. And also their focus kind of like moved in a certain direction. For example, comparing to the beginning, that the algorithms or, you know, the other stuff were also important for the user experience, such as UI. I'm going to be talking about those. And if you are wondering how they were measuring the score, so the error was in the terms of root, which means square error, root square, RSE, RSE. And the data, yeah, they released the data set, they anonymize it, they make it public, and they were competing against the recommender, the Netflix recommender, in the terms of the error on that testing set. And kind of like sad thing about the Netflix prices, they planned a sequel to that, but they kind of like canceled it. And because there were some privacy concerns about data, etc. So unfortunately, they canceled the sequel. So let's look at a method. And let's again take example of movies. And it's more complicated, but for purpose of high level introduction or explaining, I'm going to simplify it. So let's have a table or a matrix. We're going to have three users and three movies. And we have ratings here. So one means I did not really like it. Five would be that's completely awesome. Our eyes is four. We have some empty stuff, which means we have no idea or they did not rate it. And I just put here a question mark because we would like to see what would be the prediction for Jim and Alien. So what we can do now, I don't know if you're gonna see. So we have this matrix that you can see above me. And what we're gonna do, we are gonna, that's why it's called matrix factorization, we're gonna decompose it into two. This would be the user feature matrix, and this would be the item feature matrix. And so this would be on this slide. And obviously these matrices have to be in the way that, you know, if you multiply them, you're gonna get this one. So I don't know if you are familiar with this kind of like depiction of matrix factorization or matrix multiplication. So this means that, you know, multiplying this with this, I want to get this one. So I picked, the thing we have to pick is the number of rows or it's connected to number of columns. And that's the number, it's the number of features that you just have to figure out experimentally which is the best one for your domain, for your problem. So I picked two for the purpose of this example. So I'm gonna call them feature number one, feature number two in those two rows of the greenish matrix. And what is it gonna mean? It has all variables, so all are unknowns, and K will mean how much Star Trek contains or exhibits feature number one, and will mean how much Star Trek exhibits feature number two. And this is connected to the columns of this matrix.
in the terms that the first column are the user preferences for the feature number one. The second column are the user preferences for feature number two. So A will mean, in particular, how much John likes feature number one. Okay, so what are we gonna do? So we have these two matrices, we have, you know, unknowns, so, and now let's look at it, how we can express how we're gonna arrive to number three. That's observed, because we know that rating was given. And that just comes from the, you know, matrix multiplication, how we usually do it. And so the three that we observe would be how much Jim likes feature number one times how much Star Trek exhibits feature number one or contains, plus how much Jim likes feature number two times how much Star Trek contains feature number two. And you know, you would do this for all the observed cells. And then, so you end up with a bunch of equations, with a bunch of unknowns, variables. The next one you're gonna do, you're gonna run, I'm not gonna go into details of the algorithms, but the algorithm is approximative and iterative to basically calculate all the unknowns of the variable, or of the equations. And for our example, we may arrive to, let's say, these numbers after the algorithm finishes. 3.7, 3.7, etc. The numbers, the point to note here, the numbers don't have absolute meaning. So you cannot say, you know, 0.28 has absolute meaning of something. It doesn't. The thing you can do with those numbers, you can compare them. So you can say that John has or likes less feature number one than Jim. And now let's look at it. Our task was to do recommendation, to estimate how much is the question mark. And for that, we can use the exactly same equations what we had before, just for the cells that were not observed previously. So it's going to be, again, how much Jim likes feature number one times alien feature number one plus these guys, their zeros. And we're going to get approximately, it's not exactly three, approximately three. So this tells us that we think that Jim would give this movie Alien 3 stars. And if it's the highest star movie that we have in our database, then probably we should recommend it to Jim, that he should look at it. Then another thing that you may ask is, we say feature number one, feature number two, but do they have meaning? Like, can we describe them? The answer would be not necessarily. Here, by chance, you can just, you know, look at it and think about it. What's the feature that Star Trek and Alien have and Titanic doesn't have at all, comparing to what feature Star Trek and Alien don't have and Titanic has a lot? And you could say it could be sci-fi and the second one could be romance. But the point is, you don't have to do it, because it will not have a, or may have a benefit, but you don't do it because not every time it will be that clear. Sometimes, you know, the features that are extracted can be a blend of something or it can be abstract. Other thing what you can use these matrices for, once you have them, you know, if you, for example, shop or browse pages, many times you see more like this, or similar items to the one I'm looking at. So you can use this green matrix to support, kind of like to fill this tab, because you can just look, you can pick Star Trek and look, what's the most similar movie to Star Trek? Run cosine similarity on this column. Closest one, obviously, is the Alien, so you can show most similar movies to Star Trek is the Alien. You can do also the same if you need to for users. Who is most similar to John, Jim, etc. Again, using some vector similarity cosine. Good. comparison. So we covered content-based and the collaborative filtering. And kind of like a point to mention about content-based, it was kind of like studied that it produces narrower, like in quotes, so it produces more targeted recommendations with lower surprise effect. So it's gonna usually be what you were reading, watching, buying in the past. It's not gonna surprise you much. It's gonna fit your taste. But so that's kind of like downside or feature, depends how you wanna use it. The other thing is explanations. We're gonna be talking about explanations. It's good to, it's more suitable for generating explanations than the collaborative filtering. With collaborative filtering, we talked about two methods, neighborhood and matrix factorization. Matrix factorization, it's, I would say, more famous nowadays to be used. The point good to mention about matrix factorization is, because it deduces the features, it has higher potential to give you surprising recommendations. Because, as an example, let's say I'm watching romantic movies and suddenly I get a recommendation of sci-fi. For me, it's the first thing that I'm like, wow, what? Why are you giving me sci-fi when I only watch romance? But the case can be that I watch a sci-fi movie that was recommended and I end up loving it. What happened behind the scenes, or what may happen behind the scenes, is that I have been watching romantic movies, but it's not the romance as a whole, as one package, that makes me like those movies. Maybe it's some subpart that's exhibited in the romantic movies, but it's not necessarily the romance itself. And the same feature, that's how we call it, can be also exhibited in that sci-fi movie. So if you are, you know, deducing features, calculating features from the behavior, you can find this link, you can find this feature and make the link that seems to be surprising because I don't think I watch anything else. But then in the end, I end up loving that recommendation. And so that was all math. Now I'm not going to be showing you numbers. And now something beyond the algorithms. And we're going to look first the one very discussed topic is what's called cold start problem. Cold start problem is the situation when you have new user or a new item. This particularly is visible in the collaborative filtering because you use behavior only, the past behavior. So if you have a new item, you have no behavior for that. So what are you gonna do? The same happens for a new user. The new user doesn't have any past history in the system, so the collaborative filtering cannot do any recommendations for him. So how we can cope with it? So if we have new items, the simplest way what you can do, let's utilize the content-based. Because content-based doesn't have a cold start for items. Once the item is published, you know, produced, and it's new, you can, you know, get hands on it, you can extract the metadata, you know, natural language processing, depends on your system, and you have that item vector right there, and you can start recommending. So if you want to mitigate a cold start problem for the collaborative filtering, you can blend it, you can do the hybrid recommender system, combine it with the content base, and for new items, the content base will have much higher weight for deciding, is it going to be recommending, is it not? Then, as the item gets more established, more viewed, read, etc., you tune down the weight coming from the content base and you tune up the weight coming from the collaborative filter algorithm. The other part is users. So if you have new users, content base will not help you because for a new user, it has the same problem as the collaborative filter. The very simple way what you can do, you can just show them most popular, because most popular, based on the definition, is on average, most people will like it. That's why it's most popular. So you can afford show just most popular, and you may get fairly good results. And obviously, you know, once your user will get more and more behavior, you're gonna be kind of like tuning down the most popular aspect and tuning up what comes out of the, you know, collaborative or content-based approach. Other thing what you can do, you can use onboarding information. So for example, one thing that Netflix does, if you are guys on Netflix, when you are signing up, they will show you a list of movies and they're gonna tell you, and they tell you, pick three that you like. And what it gives them is they get the head start because you express your taste by choosing three, and it allows them to perform better than if you gave them no information at all. The trick with producing this list is you have to be careful so that the list is diversified. Because if you're gonna show the list that, for example, in a vector space would be like, you know, very narrow, and the user is right here, they're not gonna pick anything from that list, and they're not gonna give you good information. Or if they pick something from the range which is not particularly suitable for them, you're gonna have wrong information. So we have to diversify the list so that they can pick what they want. Other thing is, if they can, for example, give you, many times you see when you are signing up, for example, with your Facebook account. So if they can get, for example, information, or if you can get information about the user region, that's helpful. Language, if they can share friends with you, and any other information can be helpful. And one fun fact, when I was, it was pretty interesting, when I was at a conference on recommender systems, there were people from booking.com talking, and they are experiencing cold start problem quite often because you don't really go and buy vacation every day. So you have kind of like rare interactions with the system. And they, for example, found out that what works for them, besides other points, is, for example, looking at what browser you have. So if you are going to their pages, they're gonna look at, are you using Firefox, IE, Safari, whatever. They're gonna combine it, I think they mentioned also the operational system you have. So that's kind of like, it was surprising for me when they say it, like, is it really? But, you know, it depends, you know, it's up to you to analyze your audience, and if you can find that for the business you do and for the audience you have, if people with Mac behave this way and people with Windows behave that way, you may use it as well for, you know, helping you with the cold start problem. You will probably not solve it all, but it can give you help. So it's just one factor. So cold start evaluation. That's an interesting topic. So obviously, when you are building a recommender system, you want to know how well is it doing, how good it is. So you would like to evaluate. Any opinions from the audience? How would you evaluate recommender system? What would you do if you want to find out how good it is? Silence. So one thing I think came into your mind would be offline, which means you're gonna evaluate it using some computer written experiments, etc. Basically, without humans. Offline would be without humans, your computer will gather your metrics. Metrics could be mean absolute error or root square mean error. So that's basically the error, how far you are from the prediction and how you would do it. For example, if for ratings and movies, you can take historical data, you can obviously, you know, train it on one set, and then with the test set, what you're gonna do, just replay the time. And you're gonna be looking at how well at each point your recommender predicts the ratings which you hidden from the recommender. So how well is it doing? How far from the actual observed one it's gonna score? And then, you know, you count up just the error. So that's your final evaluation. Then the other thing would be online evaluation. So you can run user studies or A/B testing. And just let's stick here a little bit with offline evaluation. There's an interesting point about offline evaluation is for recommender systems, or for our presentation, is it can give you only candidates. It cannot give you the winner. And I'm gonna tell you why. So let's run an example. Let's have a movie recommender system. Let's look at
stars prediction, and let's track what's the error of the predicting stars. And let's say we suddenly find out we got it right, our error is zero, which means our accuracy is 100%, so each prediction is predicted exactly at the number of stars that the user would have given to it. Good. So another question would be, how are we going to do the recommendations? We know that the prediction of stars is absolutely awesome, the best. How are we going to serve it to the user? One way what we can do, we're just gonna pick the topmost rating. So we're gonna recommend, you know, 5-star movies or series. And that would be that. If you look at it from the user point of view, then, you know, for example, I like Oscar-winning movies and I rate it 5 stars because I think it's awesome. But I don't watch them that often. For example, every day, every weekday after work, I am, you know, my brain is tired and I don't really feel like watching an Oscar-winning movie at night. I rather go for, like, you know, funny TV show that I, for example, rate 3 or 4 stars. But that's what I want to watch because I just want to turn off my brain and I want to laugh. But then, for example, on a weekend, I want to watch some, you know, kind of like Oscar-winning movies that I normally rate 5 stars. So you can see now that if you're going to recommend according to the stars that your most accurate engine is giving to you, you're going to be accurate, but you're not going to be served or providing recommendations at the right time. And it's not going to be as interesting for me. The other point that you can look at it is, if you're 100% accurate, you've got my taste right, and that's good, and you basically are predicting with, kind of like, before I go there, you already know what I'm going to do. But you can look at it also from the other side, and that can be, if you are tailored exactly to my taste, are you going to recommend me something new? Probably not. Because I'm going to go, you know, let's say you're going to be recommending me, not movies, but let's say articles. And if I'm going to go to some newspaper page, and I know I want to read today about this thing that's happening, and you're going to recommend it to me, it's like, I was going to do it anyway. I was going to go there and read that stuff anyway. So that's not really helpful. Because you are basically giving me boring recommendations, although they are accurate, because at that time when I go there, you show it to me, that's what I'm going to do. It's 100% accurate, but it's boring because I was going to do it anyway. So that's an interesting point about offline evaluation, that obviously it's good because it gives you a good candidate. And if you are running, for example, accuracy experiments test, then, you know, if your accuracy suddenly falls from 60% to zero, there's probably something wrong about it, and you should, you know, look at it, some bug. But it doesn't really give you, this is the winner, that's what you need to deploy, that's what's going to be the best. That's why you have to do online testing. Because what you can do user studies. User studies would be, you're going to just gather some users, you're going to devise a questionnaire, and you're going to observe how the users are interacting, what steps they are doing that you tell them to do. And then you're going to gather comments. And they can tell you anything. They can tell you pretty much far beyond just the accuracy. They can tell you, I didn't like the font, I didn't like the positioning, I was interrupted too soon, etc., etc. And that's also what counts for that experience. And the other thing that's also done is A/B testing, and that means that any new feature, new algorithm adjustment, icon change, you're first going to release to 10% or some percentage of your users, let's say 10%, and you're going to look at the metrics, how is it doing. So one important thing for A/B testing is you have to have metrics. One popular metric in recommender system is called click-through rate, which means the number of times, how many times you display it, comparing to how many times they click on it, so the percentage of those. So you can be tracking this metric. You have to set up a metric that would be good enough for tracking during the A-B testing. And after you release to 10% of users, you're going to be tracking that metric. And then at the end of test, you can say, okay, this improvement, we actually got higher on our metric, so we're going to release it to 100% of users. Or you can say, oh, we really did not get better, so we're just going to roll it back. And there are interesting kind of like complements of each other between user testing and A/B testing, because during the user studies, they can give you comments, they can tell you, they can give you much more information. The kind of like thing to look for would be if you devise your questionnaire wrong, you're going to get wrong answers. And the answers might not be representative of the real behavior what the users would have done, be it in the production. On the A/B testing, you are relying on your metric, because users, they don't have a chance, or not as big of a chance, to tell you, I don't like the color, move it 5 pixels to right. Oh, it's not the color. I don't like the position, move it 5 pixels to right. So you have to be relying on your metrics. But the good thing here is, it's upside, is you let your users decide what you should roll out. Because here, on offline testing and user studies, if you do internal user studies, you are still within your business, or you're still within the people who make or who are around the system. So they might have a wrong opinion on how the users would like it. But if you give it here to the users, you kind of let them speak what they like in the terms of, are you going to use it more, are you going to use it less? And one interesting point about A/B testing, for example, Netflix A/B tests everything. So even the icon, the thumbnail or the icon of the movie, that's A/B tested, and that's carefully designed because it has the effect on the likelihood if the user click on it or not. And evaluation is also tightly coupled with recommender system attributes. So one attribute that we talked about was accuracy. And I just want to throw a couple more for you to know. Another thing that you may follow would be novelty. Novelty means if I like some main actor and there's a new movie coming out with that actor, you're going to show this movie to me, which means that's novel. It might not be surprising because I already know that main actor, but it's novel because it's new and I didn't know about it. So that's novelty. Serendipity, or also known as surprise, you may call it, is kind of, it's not entirely the novelty stuff, because you're going to show me something that I'm not aware of. So you're going to show me a movie and I end up liking it, and for example, I learn or I find out that I like a new actor. So that would be serendipitous. You're going to show me such a movie and I'm going to love it and I'm going to learn I like a new actor. Another thing is diversity. You may also track how diverse the recommendations you're producing are, because if you have 10 recommendations on movies, you don't want to have 8 out of 10 being in one series or one TV show. That would be just different episodes. That would be, again, quite boring. You want to have it diversified. And scalability. This one is kind of that it's not just recommender system. So obviously, if you have the best recommender in the world, but it takes you 5 weeks to build a model on a cluster, that's not probably very realistic and usable for the production. So you have to also account for that. And many more. Just picked several. But the most important thing that you have to always keep in mind is, what's your business target? So you should set up the metrics, the test, offline test, so that it proxies your business target. Nice analogy, a story I'm going to tell you, that's from the online course Introduction to Recommender Systems. They have a kind of like banana analogy. So if you are tasked to devise a recommender system for an American grocery store, The most bought product in American grocery store apparently are bananas. So what you can do, you may devise a recommender system that will always tell you buy bananas. Your accuracy will be high, obviously, because that's most popular product, so people buy it anyway. But if your business target or the one who hires you is increased sales or revenue, that's not probably gonna hit that business target because people are buying bananas anyway, so you're not gonna get higher sales on bananas. So always be mindful of what's your business target. If you wanna increase revenue, if you want to retain users, if you wanna have the user keep watching movies for a longer period, for example. Another category, explanations. I like this one. Explanations. So, I'm gonna pick and use audience. So, explanation is basically explaining why am I giving you this recommendation. So, I can pick a different person here. I may say, I think you would like this pen because final exams are coming up and you will wanna, you know, write during your finals and you don't wanna run out of the pen. So, the because part is actually the explanation. So what I'm doing, I'm explaining why am I giving this recommendation. And question to the audience, another try. What do you think is the ultimate goal? What's the goal of me giving that explanation? Anyone tries to guess or any opinion? Interestingly enough, I don't know if you thought about it, the ultimate goal is to increase users' trust and to make them more likely to consume or click on the recommendation. That's the only ultimate goal that you have. And if you think about it, that gives you kind of like interesting space how to devise an explanation. Because one thing that you don't have to do, if this is the ultimate goal, you don't have to give, you know, super deep detail, kind of like details on the algorithm. So if I'm gonna be offering this pen, I'm gonna say, I think you would like this pen because your feature vector number 3 is the highest one scoring, blah, blah, blah. That's not probably make you believe or make you get that. So, and you don't also wanna do it. The user study shows that you should keep it simple. You can produce a graph. So one thing what I can also say is, I think you would like this pen because, you know, people similar to you got it, or your friends are buying this pen now. And there's also another kind of like, you may find it odd explanation that I've heard somewhere in the course, is you may even say, I'm recommending to you this pen because and the reason why is because I was right 93% of times before. So it sounds odd, definitely, but you know, if you think about it, you know, if you really know that the recommender was correct in their history, you may just say, good, give it to me, I'm gonna consume it. Obviously, it depends on your audience, if they wanna receive such an explanation. And what you wanna be careful about with explanations, you should not give wrong explanation. So if I, again, pen, if I'm offering this pen, you know, I think you would wanna buy this pen, and if I'm gonna say, because summer is coming, or because your hair is brown, that's definitely, you're gonna be like, what? The recommender doesn't know what it's talking about. I'm not gonna get in this pen, no way. So, you know, that was kind of like exaggerated, but if you have, for example, a movie and you really know that you love, the only thing that you love about that movie is the actor, and the recommender is going to tell you, I'm recommending to you this movie because it's from 90s. That's a little odd because you know you really like that actor, nothing more about that movie. That's why, that's the only single reason why you watch it. And if it's going to give you wrong explanation, you're going to be thinking about like, does it know what it's talking about? And if it's gonna decrease your trust, so it's gonna decrease your trust in the system, then next time you're gonna be more careful if you are, you know, clicking, or maybe you
do more research of the recommended item before you click on it. So you don't want to increase or decrease, right? Decrease user's trust. Another interesting thing, just very briefly, attacks on recommender systems. So attacks in this particular context is not breaching, it's not like SQL injection, hijacking sessions, etc. So the attacks in this context are, are kind of like you behave in, you're not breaking any, you know, encryptions. You behave as an as if you were a normal user. This one is particularly important or visible in the collaborative filtering because you utilize the whole crowd. And the two basic types of attacks, you have a nuke versus push. Nuke means you want to downgrade an item. So you want that item to be less recommended than it should be in reality. The push attack is you want to increase the visibility of that item. You want that item to be more visible than as if it was in reality. How you can do it is if you're going to pick, for example, very simple example, neighborhood model. It's using the people similar to me to give me recommendations. So if I'm going to do that, I'm going to create 100 fictitious profile, and I'm going to do it so that I'm going to rate the items so that I'm similar to most of you. Some of my profile, some of my fictitious profile is similar to some of you or all of you. There are certain ways how you can do it. And if I want to just, let's say I like this pen and I want to promote it. So all of my 100 item or 100 user profile are going to rate this pen high. And because my fictitious accounts are similar to you, this pen is going to bubble up in your recommendations because of how the algorithm works. So that will be just in short. Just last slide, last 2 points. Context error recommender systems. So context for our case would be we are in the auditorium. It's 7 something, I think, PM. And it's Monday. That would be your context. And you can utilize the same principle in recommender systems. One thing that you can think about would be if you are looking up on your mobile, if you are looking for a restaurant, a recommendation should consider your location. So if I'm in Prague, I should not get a recommendation on a restaurant from Amsterdam. And the same could be regarding the time. So the example I was talking about earlier, that I'm going to give you different movie recommendations during weekdays than during weekends, so or in the morning than in the evening. That's also a context of time for me making a recommendation. And another thing, power to users. That's interesting point. And that's basically giving a user way how to tell the recommender is wrong. So one counter argument you can say could be, shouldn't the recommender learn by itself? Ideally, yes. But in the real world, you're going to get cases when the recommender doesn't get it completely right, or gets it only half right, or maybe wrong. And if you are a user for whom it works perfectly, then you're happy, good, nothing needs to be done. But if you are a user for whom it doesn't work, then it's for you just a black box. You don't know how to, you know, how should I tell it is wrong? I don't care about these attributes. That's not why I like this movie. So the point about power to users or user control would be to give them a way how to explain or how to give the recommender feedback. One thing that you can notice, for example, YouTube has a don't show me this recommendation, don't show me this video, or I think not interested, something like that. You can click on it.
The X button.
X button. Yeah, so dismiss or something like that. So you're just gonna say, I don't like it, I don't want to see it. Then you can say why, if it prompts you to. And that's the input, how you can tell it it's wrong. Other thing is you can expose. There was an interesting user study on movie lens. They exposed 3 different algorithms. They obviously call them some fictitious character names, and the user was able to just click, I want this algorithm, I want that algorithm. Or you can expose some high-level settings, like novelty. You can do novelty. Do you want to see newer stuff, older stuff? Do you want to see more popular, less popular? So some high-level way of correcting your recommendations. And user studies show that just the move that you're going to offer users to adjust their recommendations, that makes them happier. And after they adjusted, they felt that obviously it's more accurate for them. And you know, if it works for your users, then they don't have to use it at all. So it's kind of like, if they are happy, good. If they are bad, there's a way how to, you know, make them happier, how to fix it. Good. References. So for what I've learned in the past, I found these resources very helpful, and I also, when I was talking about user studies, etc., it was mostly coming from either the Recommender System Handbook or the Introduction to Recommender System, which is an online course on Coursera, very nice one. And some of the studies were also from the Rexis of 2012. It's a conference, big conference on recommender systems, also a good resource if you want to know more. And done. Thank you for attention. Time for questions. I'm afraid to ask. And feel free, here's my LinkedIn if you want to get in touch, you know, send a question, something. I'm always happy to talk about recommenders. You might have seen that today. Any questions?
Can we defend against those attacks you mentioned?
Yes. So there's one nice, the whole chapter on how to defend against the attacks. So there are strategies. I don't know them by heart, but for example, I know that one very easy thing that might help you is you are not going to expose what you are using for making recommendations. Or if you are going to make a hybrid, so if you're going to combine multiple of them, then it's going to be much harder to hit weakness of each of them. But I would definitely reference to the chapter in this book, it's much more comprehensive. Thank you very much for coming. I would much appreciate it.